So this is lecture number 8 and 9 of this course, Unit Process of Extraction or Principles of Extractive Metallurgy. Right? And today's topic is aluminium production, or I can say aluminium extraction. And in that particular concept, I will also discuss about calcination and leaching concept. Here you can see this leaching is actually a hydrometallurgy process. This leaching is a hydrometallurgy process, and this calcination is pyrometallurgy process. Okay. So, if we carefully look into the production of aluminium from the main principal ore that is called bauxite, right? So, it includes first hydrometallurgy. Then it includes pyrometallurgy, and finally it includes electrometallurgy. So I'll show you how these three important metallurgical processes, extractive metallurgical processes, are involved in the production of aluminium. So first thing I want to tell you that this one, the bauxite, which is the main ore of aluminium, this bauxite will become pure aluminum here. Two metallurgy are involved here actually. First one hydro, then pyro. So bauxite will undergo hydrometallurgy, then it will undergo pyrometallurgy, finally it will give you pure alumina, that is aluminium oxide, L2O3. And this is bauxite is L2O3 dot XH2O plus gangue. Okay. So this is pure aluminium. Pure aluminium means it is free from gangues basically. And next step will be the electrometallurgy. It gives you finally aluminium. So this production of aluminium involves hydrometallurgy, pyrometallurgy, and electrometallurgy. Three processes are involved: hydro, pyro, and electro. Fine. So already I have explained this one. Again, I would like to explain this one. Please have a look. So the important ore of aluminium is bauxite, which is this one, L2O3.XS2. And since this is a ore, so it will contain two things, main mineral value and the gangue mineral, right? So gangue minerals are unwanted minerals, and main minerals are the valuable minerals, right? So valuable mineral is this one, this L2O3.XS2, but the gangues are titanium dioxide, iron oxide, and silica. These are the major gangues present in the bauxite. And bauxite basically is a combination of two different ore of aluminium. So one important ore of aluminium is diaspore, and another one is gibbsite. Right? So diaspore and gibbsite difference is what? Both are aluminium oxide containing water molecules, but number of water molecules is different. You can see in diaspore the water molecule is only one. Here in gibbsite the water molecule is three. And you have to remember one important point: this water molecules are basically chemically bonded with the aluminium oxide. Okay. So the first step of aluminium production is conversion of bauxite to pure alumina, right? And which includes two different processes, hydro and pyro. So I will show you how these two important metallurgical processes are involved, hydro and pyro. So first, this bauxite will be undergo crushing and grinding. After crushing and grinding, we'll do sizing and all, right? Then we'll do concentration. So concentration process is actually a hydrometallurgical process for aluminium extraction, right? How it is? Because this fine bauxite ore will be reacted with concentrated sodium hydroxide solution, fine? So here that means concentrated sodium hydroxide solution is the leaching solution. You have to remember, this is your leaching solution. by using a leaching solution which is concentrated sodium hydroxide, we have to dissolve our metallic values into the solution, right? And the non-metallic values or the gang minerals will remain as solid residue, because the definition of leaching is what? By using a suitable liquid reagent or by using a suitable aqueous medium, we have to dissolve the main metallic values or the important metallic values and keeping the non-metallic values or gang minerals as a solid residue. That means after doing leaching, we'll get two things. One is soluble metallic value and one is the solid residue, right? Insoluble solid residue, right? So you can see, but you have to remember, this kind of leaching is actually done at high pressure. So that's why it is called pressure leaching. It is not atmospheric leaching. It is called pressure leaching because you can see the pressure involved. Pressure involved is 20 to 30 atmospheric pressure, very high pressure, right? And the temperature involved is also 230 degrees centigrade. Basically, hydrometallurgical processes are carried out at low temperature, like in room temperature. But to make the process faster, to make the extraction faster, we go for high temperature. For example, 230 degrees centigrade or 240 degrees centigrade, right? So to achieve that temperature, we can go for pressure leaching. Because we know the funda, boiling point is directly proportional to pressure. If we increase the pressure, our boiling point will increase, right? So that means we are increasing the pressure of what? We are increasing the pressure of aqueous solution, right? If we increase the pressure over aqueous solution, the boiling point will increase. That means since boiling point will increase, the aqueous solution will not get evaporated out from the container, right? Still, we can maintain a high temperature like this, 230 degrees centigrade, right? So, by doing pressure leaching, we'll end up with what? We'll end up with sodium aluminate plus red mud. Huh. So, the gang will remain in this red mud, which is insoluble. Huh. This part is insoluble. After leaching, we'll get a red mud, which is insoluble. This red mud is nothing but the gang part. Solid residue, right? And this is the soluble part, sodium aluminate. So this is the main substance which we need for production of aluminium, sodium aluminate. So this sodium aluminate is then hydrolyzed. The next step is what? After doing leaching, next step we'll do what? We'll filter it. We'll take it. We'll discard the red mud. We will collect this solution, sodium aluminate solution, and the sodium aluminate solution will be hydrolyzed first. We'll add lot of water, then it is precipitated. Then upon precipitation of this hydrolyzed sodium aluminate, we'll get aluminium hydroxide, right? So we'll get aluminium hydroxide, in some people say also called hydrated aluminium oxide, right? Why? Because water molecule is bonded with the aluminium oxide. So it is hydrated aluminium oxide or aluminium hydroxide. So we'll get this one. But since the point is what? It is a hydrated aluminium oxide. That means water molecule is still chemically bonded with this aluminium oxide. We have to remove this water molecule, right? Before processing, we need to remove this water molecule. That water molecule can be removed by calcination process, which is a pyrometallurgical process, right? So you can see aluminium hydroxide will undergo calcination, and that calcination is carried out at a temperature of 1200 to 1300 degrees centigrade. Since it is a calcination process, it is a decomposition process actually. Thermal decomposition process. We want to decompose a compound into its own constituent. So your initial compound is aluminium hydroxide. It will decompose into aluminium oxide plus water. This water molecule is go. It will get removed. Right? So now finally we'll get a pure alumina, which is free from water molecules. This pure alumina then undergoes electrolysis process. Finally, it will give you aluminium. Okay. So you can see the first step is hydrometallurgy process, which is pressure leaching. The next step is your calcination process, which is pyrometallurgical process. And last step is the electrolysis process. So that means you have to remember, starting from bauxite to this much. Up to this. Starting from bauxite to this much, this process is called Bayer's process. And from here, from pure alumina to aluminium is called Hall-Heroult process. That is the electrolysis process. Fine. So I think you people have understood. Already I have written bauxite bearer process will give you pure alumina. Pure alumina by applying Hall-Heroult process will give you aluminium. Right. So this is the production of aluminium. So I would like to explain about the electrolysis of this pure alumina to get aluminium now. That is the important topic here. So now I talk about electrolysis. Electrolysis of pure alumina. This pure alumina is obtained by Bayer's process by doing hydro and pyrometallurgy, and finally this pure alumina will undergo electrolysis to give you pure aluminium. So it is carried out. So what are the things you want to do electrolysis? What are the requirements? The first requirement will be your electrolytic cell, right? Okay, I am not writing, then I will draw the diagram, then I will write better. So you need what? You need an electrolytic cell. Suppose this is your electrolytic cell. Fine. And since this electrolytic cell is nothing but a furnace, you can understand this is actually a furnace. And it will be covered with refractory lining. So this is your electrolytic cell. In industry they call this as a pot. That's why they are called pot lines. This is a pot or electrolytic cell, and this is, as I told, this is a furnace. And this is a furnace. And so this part is nothing but your refractory. Refractory lining. Refractory lining always protect the outer shell. This outer shell, this is your actually, this part is the outer shell. Outer shells are basically metallic materials, like suppose mild steel. And then refractory lining is there. Refractory lining is used to protect the outer shell. Okay? And inside this furnace, chemical reactions will carry out, electrolysis will be carried out. Right? So we have. This is actually what? Here also, in this part, okay, I mean here, this part is actually cathode. This is connected to the terminal. Suppose this is connected to the terminal. Is negative terminal, right? So this part is connected to the negative terminal, right? And top part, here it is. Here what is happening? We are motor part is cathode and this part is anode, fine. These are actually nothing but carbon blocks. Pure carbon blocks. These are carbon blocks, huh? These are pure carbon blocks. So from the top, anode is there, at the bottom, cathode is there, right? So that means the first state in the first requirement for the electrolyte is electrolytic cell, which is there. Second one is we need anode and cathode. Those are electrodes actually. So we need a electrolytic cell, we need electrodes. One electrode will be cathode, one electrode will be anode, right? Depending upon the connection. Because this end is connected to the negative terminal, so it becomes cathode, and this end is connected to the positive terminal, so this is anode, and these are carbon blocks basically. Fine. And we need what? We need solvent, or that is called
electrolyte.
Very good. So this is here actually in aluminium extraction, this is your solvent. Right. This is your solvent. This is an electrolyte. And from here also we charge aluminium. So your pure alumina is your solute, and this electrolyte is a solvent. Huh. And basically we use cryolite, Na3AlF6. Right. Some people write 3. Okay, this is okay. Na3AlF6, cryolite. Huh. Some people call it cryolite bath. So this is sometimes called bath, or some people call it electrolyte, right? So first requirement is the electrolyte itself, second requirement is the electrodes, one is cathode, one is anode, and you need a electrolyte. Huh? And this is actually, you have to remember, this cryolite is a molten electrolyte. This is not an aqueous electrolyte. Because aqueous electrolyte means water will be there with the salt. But here this is a salt, but this salt is in molten state. That's why it is a molten electrolyte. No water is there. This is not an aqueous solution, this is a molten solution. Right? And we are feeding alumina from the top. So this alumina will go into this molten cryolite. So what will happen? Alumina will get dissolved into the cryolite. So while we are using cryolite electrolyte, because in this salt, molten salt, dissolution of alumina is good. Right? We can dissolve up to 15% of alumina into this cryolite. Right? So now, we need what? We need, this is, you have to remember, this is called, this is DC supply. This power supply is DC supply, direct current. This is not an indirect current, this is a direct current, right? This is not an alternating current, this is direct current. Direct current means the polarity will remain same, right? That means this part will always remain anode, this part will always remain cathode, right? So this is the concept. So now what happens? Yeah. So first, I'll write the steps. The first step will be what? As I told, first step will be alumina will get dissolved into cryolite. So dissolution of your alumina into cryolite, molten cryolite. Huh? This is pure alumina. Dissolution of pure alumina into molten cryolite. This is the first step. So alumina will get soluble into this cryolite. So next step will be, since we are providing high voltage is given. So this is basically 4 to 5 volt is given. But current given is very high. Very high current will be there, but volt is 4 to 5 volt. Okay. So voltage requirement is 4 to 5 volt. Okay. Then next step will be what? Dissociation of this alumina. This alumina will get dissociated into aluminium ions. Into what? Into aluminium ions and O2- ions. Right? So alumina will dissociate into aluminium ions and oxygen ions. So this is positive ion, this is negative ion, or this is cation, this is anion. Right? So now
just imagine we have a situation like we have Al3 positive, O2 minus. We have O2 minus, we have Al3 positive. Right? This is the situation now. So what is happening? If this kind of ions will generate, and already we have two different electrodes, one is cathode, one is anode. So what will happen? This, since this is positive charge, so this will get attracted towards the cathode. This will get attracted towards the cathode. But what happens to the negative ions or anions? This will get attracted to this anode. Right? Anode is positive, so negative charge will attract to the positive electrode, right? And positively charged ions will attract to the negative electrode, right? So finally, what happens? This alumina Al3 positive will get reduced. It get electron and it get reduced to aluminium. So finally, what happens at the bottom? At this bottom of this shell, at the bottom of this shell, you have now aluminium. Right? Al3 positive will take 3 electrons, become aluminium, and get settled at the bottom of the pot or electrolytic cell. Right? Then what happens is oxygen. Oxygen will move to the carbon blocks. They react with carbon and it will give you carbon dioxide. Carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide gases. So what happens? This will remove in form of CO2 or CO. And during this process also we add some salts. Molten cryolite is not only the solvent present. We have some fluorides, some chlorides. Right. So sometimes what happens? This gases also contain some fluorides, chlorides. Basically, they are not really chloride, fluoride. They react with carbon to form the compound of gases, right? So, what is the third step? Third step will be reduction. Right? Reduction and what? Deposition of aluminium. Reduction of Al3 positive and deposition of aluminium at the bottom of pot. Okay? Right? So this is the production of aluminium basically. So you have to remember one important point. These carbon blocks are like they are like in hanging positions. These carbon blocks are actually consumable electrode. They get consumed during the process. That means after some days they are replaced with fresh carbon blocks, right? Because they get consumed. They are not soluble. You should understand. Soluble means this electrode will dissolve. But these are not soluble. These are consumable electrode. People get confused between consumable electrode and soluble. So these are consumable, right? And finally, what happens after production, when the amount of aluminium will be more in the pot, we have to take it out. We have to take it out by a process. We create pressure and this aluminium will come out, right? So this is the thing, right? So okay, I want to tell you something about this also. During this process, sometimes what happens, a major issues occur inside the pot. What is the major issue? Voltage sometimes increases in the pot. The voltage, the problem. The problem is during the operation of this pot, voltage increases. See, we don't want high volt. We want only a voltage of 4 to 5 volt. But if the voltage will be more and more and more, what will happen? Unwanted dissociation reaction will happen. We don't want to dissociate cryolite. We don't want to dissociate any kind of fluorides, any kind of salt. We only want to dissociate this alumina, right? Our major concern is the dissolved alumina should dissociate into aluminium ions and oxygen ions. We don't want to dissociate this compound, Na3AlX6. Right? Or we don't want to dissociate any calcium fluoride or sodium fluoride. Or any other salts like sodium chloride or potassium chlorides are present. Right? So if the voltage will be increased, what happens? The unwanted dissociation will occur.
maybe the cryolite will dissociate, maybe the calcium fluoride, sodium fluoride, or sodium chloride or potassium, they will dissociate. So that is the unwanted dissociation, right? We don't want that. So that process actually is called you remember?
Hydrogen over voltage. Hydrogen over
voltage. No. That process is called effect. One effect is there. Okay. What exactly happens? Let me explain it. What exactly happens? See, if lot of So what happens? We are feeding alumina, and this alumina will get soluble into this cryolite. Then the reaction will start, fine? Because these are solids, actually. Solid powder. These alumina are actually in form of solid powders. Right? So what exactly happens? Sometimes this alumina solubility reduces in the cryolite, in the bath. So the amount of alumina in the bath, if reduces below 3% sometimes or below 2.5%, what happens? Actually, this bath should contain at least 10% of alumina every time during the process, or maybe above 10. But sometimes what happens, the percentage of alumina in the bath get reduced below 3% or below 2.5%. So in that condition, unwanted dissociation starts actually. And due to this unwanted dissociation, what happens? Formation of gaseous film will occur around the anode. These are actually gaseous film. These are actually gas films. Due to unwanted reactions, the lot of gaseous films will form around the anode. And these gaseous films are what? Bad conductor of electricity. These are poor conductor or bad conductor. We are providing current from anode to cathode, right? But since there is a gaseous film around the anodes, the current will not easily pass. If current will not easily pass, what happens? The resistance will be more. Resistance to the flow of current will be more. And we understand if resistance will be more, voltage will obviously increase. So the voltage will increase inside the pot. So that is the major issue. So the solution also, we know the solution. What we can do? We can, in that condition, we can add more amount of alumina. That is one of the solution, because when amount of alumina is reducing, this kind of problem is happening, right? But if we increase the amount of, we feed more and more alumina into the process. That is one of the solution. And second solution is we can remove these gases film. How it can be removed? Sometimes in industry we insert some bamboo sticks, dry bamboo sticks. So when we insert dry bamboo sticks into this bath, then what happens? There will be agitation of bath will occur, and due to agitation of bath, the liquid bath will touch this anode, and all these gases film will remove during this process. So this is the solution. So this is the major issue in the aluminium production, and that is the solution.